Hello YouTube. We are going to check out a couple of really cool plugins by a company known as Phuturetone. And these plugins are absolutely free. They look amazing and they sound pretty damn good. You're going to find that they are only 32-bit though and only for Windows, so that's a problem for Mac people, but definitely worth checking these guys out in my opinion. So the plugins are a Juno, Roland Juno emulator, and a Sherman Filterbank emulator. I guess you could say they're inspired by. I don't know if they're necessarily 100% excuse me, 100% emulations, but so I just wanted to take some time and go through some things, and I made some notes about these plugins, and hopefully you find this useful. So the first plugin that we're going to look at, I'm going to close the filter down right now, is Phutura, and it comes with the standard atypical Juno sounds, which are a lot of hoovers, right, which is what this synth kind of was known for in electronic music. And there's a whole bunch of them. So there's a super saw oscillator going on. And I don't know anything about the original hardware. Right, and in addition to that, there's some kind of typical sounds that you might hear in the other categories like bass, pad, leads, sound effects, and so on. So let me open up the project again because I don't want to lose my patch. And right, so let's go through this real quick. Excuse me, and actually, you know what? I do want to lose my patch. I want to choose a different init. I think 111 is free. So first of all, when you init the synth, you do it by choosing patch select in any of these init slots from user 81 to 128. And when you do that and you play keys, nothing is going to come out. That's because none of the oscillators are sending a signal at this point. If you increase the level of the sub, you will start to hear something, right? Or the saw, or the pulse, right? So saw, pulse, and sub are how this thing makes sounds. Those are the oscillators on deck here. So let's go through them one by one real quick. So the sawtooth, this very standard sawtooth, right, pretty standard saw. And then you have other options for the saw wave. And you can, once it gets up here, you can change the modulation on the saw, which is that super saw sound. And there's some degraded saws, right? So it has a super saw sound available. We can also turn chorus on and off, which is going to make it sound really, really fat, right? And then I'm pretty sure only the super saw is affected by this guy. Yep. Okay, so these knobs do double duty, by the way, depending on what's going on in the synth. As you can see, there's no pulse width or PWM here. These are not active unless the super saw is enabled, which looks like this. And you can turn off oscillation. Of the pulse width, modulation rather. You turn off modulation on the pulse width by going to off. So the chorus is huge. It makes the sounds enormous, which is cool. And then the next waveform is our pulse, and I'm going to go ahead and normalize these, control clicking, double clicking. I guess it doesn't affect those, but on some of them, some of the controls it does, or it did. Maybe I'm wrong. Okay, so let's look at the pulse. So standard square wave here. Something to note is you have minus one octave or plus one or plus two octave. And you don't have individual control over the pitch of the saw versus the pulse or the sub. They're all kind of slave to the core pitch here. And you don't even get any fine tuning or anything. Not by interval and not by anything but octave. right, so that's the pulse. Nothing going on with these knobs at this point. But when you get to this one, you can see from the dotted lines in the same way that you had with that. This implies modulation. So I'm going to take it all the way off. You can hear how it's crunching that period in the pulse wave, right? And this is basically an oscillator individual for this purpose. Can sound pretty fat. Okay, and then we also have this one, which I believe is like a 25%, this is 50, 25, and then variable. So that's the pulse wave. And then we have the sub. I'm gonna take this up to two real quick. Also, something to note is when you're playing with this synth and the tactile feel of it, you wanna click on the actual knobs. You can't click on the lanes to adjust. You can't click and jump. You have to actually click on these and drag a bit up and down. So the sub, by default, is slaved one octave lower than the core pitch. So if I enable my pulse wave, you can hear it's one octave lower than whatever the regular oscillators are set up for. So I'm gonna take that off, right? And then you have different subtypes. You have a sub that's a 50% duty cycle, 25%. Then you have a like a double octave one. Just the sub alone has two octaves there. I believe that's three octaves. They're smaller pulse widths though. And then you have two octaves down from the core. Everything is slave to this, remember. So that's two octaves down, and then you have three octaves down. Well, actually, it's 25%, but when you're using it with other things, it starts to sound deeper. You can hear it, right? So that's the sub, and you can also have noise. And there's no variable adjustment of this. It's only these three settings, nothing, one, two, and three values. This is just pink noise, I believe. And noise has no effect with the core octave here. It doesn't do anything. There's no tonality to the noise. Right, and then we have, put the sawtooth back on here. Then we have, in the pitch section, we have the ability to use an LFO. It's the same LFO. There's one LFO for this whole thing, which I guess is kind of like how the Juno was. Interesting to note here is that the LFO can be delayed, and it's a slow fade in, right? So that's a nice feature. I don't know if that was in the hardware. Another thing that you can do is make it so that all modulation using the LFO requires the mod wheel to introduce it. by dragging that slider all the way, or this knob all the way up. You can take it somewhere halfway, and it's only half in effect until, or something like this. So it's got a little bit until you crank that mod wheel, which is nice touch there. In addition to the LFO, well, I guess we should mention this, the rate is MIDI synced. It's multiples of the BPM. And it's modulation rate, it's not audio rate. So that's good to know. The next interesting thing about the pitch section is the portamento time, which provides some glide when you play legato style. It can go pretty long. Pretty neat. And this is great for those bass lines. Especially when you're doing some super soft stuff and you want smooth slides like this. Juno Reactor, anyone? So that's pretty cool. And then you can do pitch modulation using the envelope. And this is a pretty interesting envelope implementation in that they have different modes of operation here. So you have your regular ADSR envelope here, right? And then you also have an inverted envelope. And you also have this little D, which stands for dynamics. And what this means is that it is velocity sensitive, in essence. And if you increase the dynamic range knob, this will govern how much sensitivity there is for velocity. And I'll show you more of that when we get to the filter. Then you also have an inverted velocity sensitive envelope. The next up is the amplitude module, and there are several modes for the amp end, the same ones that are available for the filter, but then also some gates. So right here is the amplitude is governed by this envelope, right? Which is good for pads, right? Or, sequencer sounds or whatever. Whatever sounds you like with that envelope. And you can use the same envelope for pitch, the amplitude, and the filter all at once, which is a very simple setup, but it actually can yield some pretty decent sounds. Then we also have gate, which has a tiny bit of release on the tail to make it not pop, it sounds like, because I can't get it to sound like this. Hear that popping? And if you listen to the gate, see there's a tiny bit of release there. And I'm not sure what decision was made for that, but it's okay. It works okay. And then we also have velocity sensitive envelope. So if we turn up our dynamic range here, I'm playing lighter on the keyboard, playing harder. You can hear how that works. And then you have a velocity-sensitive gate as well, which is a nice touch because you can use this to get some pretty good expression on the VCA side of things while you modulate, say, your filter and your pitch with the actual envelope. Pretty neat. And that's all of the modes that are available there. Interesting to note is that you can't invert the amplitude envelope. Obviously, you have your chorus on and off. Nice thick sound, instant stereo sound, which is signature sound, I guess, for this synth. One of the things that it did really well. Okay, and then we have, in addition to that, you have your master level, which is pretty decent adjustment. You start, I believe I thought I could initialize it by hitting control click. All of the knobs and controls are MIDI learnable. You can MIDI learn them simply. Let me turn on my external knobby knobs, and I'll learn this. So I've mapped up. It looks like there's a hardcore. There's a hardcore CC for filter. So let's just choose none for that. And now I have my knob on my keyboard modulating this, and you can unlearn it so it doesn't do anything. And you can edit it and do it manually here. I believe this is a Synth Edit plugin. This looks familiar to me, but the quality of this plugin is pretty high. And I think the guy bought Synth Edit or whatever he did. Maybe it's a hybrid, I don't know, but it looks really good. He did a great job. I wouldn't know it was Synth Edit unless I did certain things like this, which maybe he was just inspired by it, I don't know. But Windows 32-bit only makes me think Synth Edit. So that's the top section sorted. Let's actually go over on this side real quick. So you have pitch bend. And you can go up or down by up to 12 semitones. Or none, which is nice. Actually, I quite like that you can do zero. So you could do, you know, two, which is like very standard. Three. Right, so any kind of thing you want to do there. Really good for some leads and bass lines. As I mentioned before, the mod wheel can be used to stimulate or enable the different modulation of the LFO in the different sections for pitch, filter, and so on. There's no amplitude LFO. So here I've configured my pitch to have extreme LFO modulation, and I can't hear it until my mod wheel is engaged, which is a very nice, simple implementation. Conversely, if you have it on zero, then your mod wheel will only be keyed to the filter. And let me show you this. So there's a hard patched signal for modulating the filter built into LFO 1, at least there is by default. Let's see, maybe the factory. You know, it's just hard coded. So you can hear the filter cutoff is keyed in hardcore to, or hardwired to the filter. I mean the mod wheel rather. So, and then we have our LFO rate, which is just a tempo synced thing. Right, and then we have a delay for that LFO like we talked about. Okay, now let's go to the filter. I'm gonna go to a new user init. Again, it's silent until we send a signal to it. And we're gonna talk about the filter. So, really simple filter. You can have key tracking enabled, and then the envelope mode is individual. Even though you have only one envelope, you can have different modes enabled for each of the different sections, which is nice. So HPF is high pass filter. There are three settings. Completely off, let everything through. Kill some of the bass, kill more of the bass, kill almost all the bass. Right? So that's how the HPF works. I'm gonna take the sub down. And then you also have your standard, you know, low pass filter. That's what this is. It's not mentioned, but you have a high pass here and a low pass here. Something to note is that the resonance is quite nice on the filter. And it's probably why the developer created a Filterbank mod plugin after he probably got inspired by his own work or something. But it sounds pretty damn good. It's not, you know, it's not the drop or anything, but it's pretty good. Get some nice resonance out of that guy. It is self-resonating as well. Oh no, it isn't. Let me see if I... Nah. It's not self-oscillating. I mean, self-resonating doesn't make any sense. It's not self-oscillating. Okay, and then so that's that, you know, set up there. And then you have your LFO to modulate your filter frequency if you want to. You can introduce a nice little delay to it. And in poly mode, I believe you get 8 voices, polyphony. I don't know if all the filters are, or I mean, all the envelopes are individual per poly. Let's see. It It sounds like maybe they could be copies. Yeah, it sounds like you get individual and not a shared envelope, which is nice. So you can do that, and then you can have the different modes, as I mentioned. You can have a normal envelope, inverted one, and then velocity sensitive. Also, you can have velocity sensitive gate down here. So I'm hitting the keys really lightly. I need to turn this on in order for this to work, though. So it's easier to demonstrate this with an envelope. Barely hitting it. Actually, let's use... Right. So, yep, that's how that works. And then you also have key tracking enabled for your filter. So it's automatically tuning the filter response. The lower you go, the less effect it will have. I think it's just a linear slope. That's with it off. You can hear you get a lot of those highs come through a little bit better when that's enabled. Right? And then the resonance can interact with all of these things as well. So there's no modulation of the resonance parameter, however. It's all just cutoff modulation. Then you have your standard four-stage envelope with attack, decay, sustain, and release. I guess you can have amplitude velocity sensitive. Yeah, you can. I don't know why I said you couldn't. So yeah, that's kind of like the layout of the Phuturetone stuff. So I've created a couple demonstrations that I would like to share of patches that I whipped together real quick. And I have a song at the end that I can show as well. So this is just a really simple deep sounding patch, nothing special there. Let's look at this one. Okay, so this one is using Philteroid after it. And there's actually a kick drum on this guy. If I hit play and I start passing it through, you can hear there's a kick. What's cool about Philteroid, whoops, is the ability to follow the envelope or have an envelope follower. So you can see my kick drum is stimulating Philteroid. And we'll go over this plugin in a moment, but I wanted to show you this so I could show you this patch. So sounds pretty cool. Great for trance sounds. Also note that the CPU use when Philteroid is enabled is pretty high. Without it, it's not nearly as bad. I mean, it's not perfect, but there's also some other stuff I've got going on here for other patches to show you. Right, so that's one patch, and we'll go over Philteroid in a minute. I want to show you what this sounds like with an ARP setup and how I've set up my Ableton setup here is I have the BlueARP, which is a free arpeggiator / step sequencer plugin. It's awesome. And I'll put the link in the description. I made a skin for it that looks kind of like Bitwig. And I made my live look a little bit Bitwig-ish because I like me some Bitwig skin. Right. So the BlueARP is set up so that it's on an individual MIDI track, and then I'm recording both of these. Then I'm sending, or I'm sorry, I'm accepting the BlueARP for the MIDI for the Phutura plugin, which is that Juno emulator I just went over. And I'm pointing to its output as an input for the MIDI from, and I set monitoring to in. What I wanted to show you is that for free, you can get a pretty dope setup that also looks good. Check this out. These guys together look pretty dang cool. Which we all know, you know, does factor into the reason we want to use them or not. And then I've got other examples that I'm going to show you in a moment on the Phutura synth here. So this is another patch that I made. Actually, this one I think I picked. Yeah, no, I just picked this one. I didn't make it. But it's got the envelope follower again. You can hear a totally different effect than what I had configured before, right? And the envelope follower to set it up was a little bit interesting. So basically it takes a sidechain is how you have to think of it. So I have my audio sidechain source here, right? You can hear it stimulating that, right? And this is just getting me the sound not passed through Philteroid because I'm sending the audio from my audio track, my sidechain that I've configured here, to input 3 and 4 of Philteroid. There are actually 3 stereo ins. And you can configure it down here. We're going to go over this in a second, but that's another patch type. And this one was kind of interesting too, if I recall. Let's see what's going on here. Yep, I have them both on, so let's play it. This is a sound that was built in. Right. So let's take a look at this sound. It's a factory sound built into it. Also notice that when I engage Philteroid, we lose some of that stereo spread. And that's because this plugin's architecture is a little bit interesting. You have the ability to use dual monos at the output or a stereo, and then each filter controls left or right accordingly. So, and there's no way that I've found to sync them together. This link thing doesn't do it as far as I can tell. Or if it does, I don't know. There's no manual with this, so I had to kind of figure things out on my own. But, yeah, so this is one of the patches that I quite liked. There are several decent factory ones. A pretty exhaustive, diverse selection. It's cute. Right. So, and then there's one more example that I created a baseline using everything. I'm trying to think how I've got this set up. I've got it's a similar thing, and it's just using a combination of more things. So this baseline, turn down the master a bit. This baseline was from a VST that I'm going to cover in a future video called Beat Breaker, I believe. Beat Buster, something like that. It's an old one, but a good one. And not a lot of people know about it, which is kind of like the theme I'm going for here. But you can hear, I've configured that envelope follower to use this signal. See, this guy is just a kick. He's not doing anything besides laying down a kick. That bass line is being used as a sidechain for the filter. say 80s. Pretty cool. So the point of using this example was to kind of let you know that you can get creative with your signaling. Also, this plugin is really very versatile. There are different ways to trigger your ADSR, including MIDI. So it will send, it will work on any note on signal, which is pretty cool. And you can configure it in many different ways. I'm going to go over this plugin in one minute. I just want to show you one more thing so you know what to look forward to here. I got a legato lead sound programmed, which sounds baller. It sounds like it's just so cool sounding. So dark and cool. Pretty cool. And there's another one. Let's see what this one is. I also have a limiter on the master, obviously. I think it was just a variation on the same with some LFO. It was just a variation on the same one. And then the last thing was I created a whole track using nothing but Phutura. And I have TAL Reverb 4 on my Reverb Send. And that's it. It's just Phuturas for every sound, including bass drum, snare drum, close hat, clap, everything for the drums. I've got Live's Glue compressor on there, and then I've got a copy of CLAS, which is basically the BBE process for free. Again, I'll put a link in the description, but this sounds like this. It's not great, but it's a decent example. So those are all drums that were created with only Phuturas. And then here we have the kick only, which is a very common sound, easy to program. Actually struggled a little bit on the very simple architecture of this to make this happen, but I was able to sort it in the end. I had to use the pitch envelope, the filter envelope, and the gate mode. So if you look inside of the bass kick, you can see these are in short notes, but if I extend them, you can start to hear some tone, right? Some may call that a feature, but not me. Typically in other synths, I would not have any tone on the kicks like that. Anyway, let's get this back into the time, right? And then the next one is our snare, which is a very generic high sounding snare. It's not the greatest snare, but it works. And then I'll turn off the reverb for a moment so you can hear it. In essence, this just used noise and then our high pass filter and some envelope tricks to make this sound. Next up is our closed hat, which is also, as you can hear, noisy. And you can use the pitch envelope to create a more metallic sound. And then next up is the clap sound, which is actually not as obvious until you turn on the snare too. And in this case, it's just a good demonstration of saying that, you know, you could stack these synths to create different sounds, obviously the same copy in like a live rack, which is neat. And then you can also see this cowbell sound, which is just a really high pitched, sound without any bass. Right, this high pass filter does. He chose good thresholds, I think, when he designed this. And turning the chorus on and off will get you that wider sound or not. Next up is the bass line, which is just a basic bass line, and I did automate a little bit of it, but not much. Inside of Live, I believe I have some mod wheel stuff going on, and it sounds pretty weird without the kicks and stuff, but sounds cool with them. What I found is it's kind of hard to tame multiple copies of this without using EQs, but I just wanted to demonstrate anyway. But that sounds pretty okay. This is way too fucking loud. And then the other thing I did was create that lead sound, which is that Kraftwerk-y kind of like Trans-Europe Express inspired thing, which is just a super saw with some wobbly modulation, pulse width modulation, no sub or anything, and no bass. This was the hardest part of working with this synth, because there's just too many frequencies, and it's hard to tame them, and you only have the HPF and an LPF. I'm sure if spending a little more time I could figure it out, but then, and I have a wobble that can sound pretty cool, which is just, you know, LFO modulation set up on the filter using the mod wheel in this value crank, so that no modulation happens until we modulate modulate with the mod wheel. And altogether it sounds like this. Which is not the greatest sound, but it was a quick example. And then the reverb adds a little bit of pizzazz to it all. This is what it sounds like soloed. And as you see, the things that I'm sending, bass is, the kick isn't getting sent, the bass line isn't getting sent, and neither is the wobble. But some of the higher frequency stuff is getting sent, like the hats, the snares, and our lead line. Right. And then this is what it sounds like without CLAS, which, like I said, is the free BBE process. Makes it a little bit more present. It's basically an exciter. It's subtle, but it's there. And then we've got our limiter. So yeah, that's the Phutura part of it. Now let's take a look at the Philteroid. So the Philteroid is the Sherman Filterbank clone. And this sound is going to be a little loud. Let me go ahead and adjust that. I wanted it to be this way because I want to control my Philteroid from the bender. And I'll show you this. It's just an example. Pretty cool. See the bender? Also, I changed this pitch bend to zero so it wouldn't have any influence on the tone. That way you can have independent control with Phuturoid, or Phutura and Philteroid following it. You can use mod for your filter coming into your Philteroid, and then your bend for the Philteroid filter. Right. So let's go ahead and choose an init patch. And let's send a super saw. And let's go ahead and init our Philteroid. So this plugin is definitely difficult to come to grips with. And I know that I had a hard time with it as well. So first of all, you can't hear anything right now, because the way that it's set up. And I want these to be stereo. And I want to check something. Right. Okay, I just want to make sure that our sound is coming through. Okay. So first of all, let's go over the top menu. So this will save your patch. This will show your patch select, no big deal. This will initialize the knobs, but it leaves all this stuff intact, and this will randomize them. Clicking that will go to the Phuturetone website, which I recommend doing. They have some free refills, which are pretty cool for Reason, and I'll cover those in a later video perhaps. But this is the Filterbank 2, and this is what the Philteroid is modeled on. There's no manual or anything, so you just got to know what you're doing. And then this is the page for the Juno simulator. Right. So what's really hard about this plugin is it's so flexible. And it took me a while just to figure out that left and right were just basically set up for each of those filters. And then we're going to really do a really quick flyby of the plugins GUI real quick in just the main section. So at the top, you have the patch stuff, and then you have what you use to control the filter in general. And you can use, like I had, pitch bender. Right, and this is interesting to note also that I have a separate MIDI track in live configured to route to Phutura's track, which is where that synth is at, and then the Filteroid plugin to it. And so you can see, without, if I don't do this, the Phutura plugin doesn't pass through the information to Filteroid. So that's something to note. And why can't we hear it? Well, because we're not really filtering anything. So if you turn down the cutoff, then you can start to hear something. The default configuration is serial, which means it goes into filter one and then filter two. This is important to note because in the in-between setting, you get a mix of both of them. And this is the only way that I was able to figure out how to get it to sound stereo output at all. And there might be a different way using audio tracks and stuff, but that's okay. So anyway, control is the overall external control of how you want to set up your filter. And then you have your signal, and you can send mono from left or the right. It doesn't matter in our case here. We're going to do a stereo signal in. And I'm going to actually put this back to serial mode for a moment. And again, I can't hear anything because the cutoff is down there. Let's do an in-between setting. Right. So that's the audio input. Then you also have frequency modulation, and this can be the signal itself, the internal LFO, the internal ADSR, which is the envelope follower, or an audio source from the outside. That is pretty dope. And I think that this is, for free, this is insane. It's basically the poor man's the drop, is kind of how I interpret this. Because you can do some pretty cool stuff, so let's go ahead and hit play. And we got that kick drum, right? And in this case, it's too fast. Let's take this. Let's try something like that. And we'll use that as an FM input, because we're going to send it to, you know, you can see, to the Phutura Filteroid plugin. On input 3 and 4, we're going to choose right here, input 3. And you can hear that little reactor loop is actually modulating the FM. Pretty cool. And then if you just choose nothing, if you just use signal in, that's a default, which means it's going to self-modulate using its own signal for FM, which can add some pretty decent brightness. It's kind of... it's pretty cool. And then you have... let's go ahead and take that down and normalize this a bit. Then you have the ability to use the LFO as well, which is cool. Now in this case, LFO depth is set to nothing, so you're not going to hear anything. But when I increase the LFO depth... now this LFO is actually audio rate. Which is pretty nifty. And then you can also choose the envelope follower itself, inbound. Now, in order for this to work, we need to set up a couple things. First of all, you have a standard envelope when you're not using the envelope follower, right? When you're not sending it audio. Hear that? Okay. These lights tell you if the gate is on or off. Not bad. And then obviously, I already showed you that. You can also do MIDI trigger, so you don't even need to depend on the gate, which is just picking up the note on and note off. So using this as an FM depth control, I think it's going to use the note number or something. I don't know, I can't figure out how to, I can't figure out how that works. So anyway, that's the FM piece. Then you have the ADSR, and this is pretty cool. So this is where I had it sidechained before, right? And this part is where it gets a little fiddly too. We want to make sure that we are increasing our sensitivity. And you can see that the loop, see here, is actually triggering the gate. I want to do this with the kick. Okay, because it's easier to understand. And so the reason this isn't having any influence is because the envelope, this is the envelope modulation amount. Right? And there's different modes of operation here. One is, I think it looks like a combination of the standard envelope plus the envelope follower. That's the way I'm reading this. Let's see. But it's less intense, right? Another thing to note is that it seems to be more sensitive to the bass frequencies for triggering it. You can hear that it's only slightly triggering it with some of those higher sounds. You can also trigger this with MIDI, which I presume is just going to use the gate value, yeah. So every note I send is re-triggering that. You still have to modulate, even no matter what you pick here. This is not going to modulate the filter cutoff unless you choose that, right? And these are the envelope follower modes. One is, I've had mixed results with this. When it's on, let's let it hit. See? Well, actually this needs to be on in anyway, or it will not work anyway. So yeah, so. From what I can tell, the sensitivity amount here is governed by this, and when it's sensitive you get higher peaks, it seems. Yeah, see, when this mode is in this mixed mode where it's mixing the envelope and the follower, if you put it on limited, doesn't seem to respond to the input signal. So I don't know what the magic is going on behind the scenes here. But I typically like this anyway, so if you guys can figure it out, let me know. Also, there's a treble cut or a boost or no effect, so you can just tame your filter sound a bit. Then there's this track transpose thing, and as far as I know, I think this makes it playable with the note MIDI note in. And my guess is that you can set it up to be tracking like a regular key tracker. And then the tracking mode, I think this is, I don't know what this is for. I've never been able to understand what it does. My guess is it's CPU related or quality somewhere, but I don't know where. So anyway, that's filter one. Then you obviously have resonance. And see, I'm like changing things and it has no effect. Also, these are bipolar. So if we wanted to do the opposite effect, let's do it on a slower kick. So this is sucking the sound, so it's an inverted response to this. Right? So that's cool. And then in the middle, they have no effect. Double clicking on these guys is what worked. The other plugin doesn't have that. This thing can sound nasty too. The filter is pretty cool. Now this is what filter type you have, and it's a smooth blend between low pass, band pass, and high pass. Which is cool. So you can get some nasty sounds. You can configure, you can configure these in parallel mode also, so they're both sending out at the same time. So let's try and configure it for a pass-through. I guess that would be the pass-through. Whoa, what is going on there? Did you hear that? That's wild. That's that resonance. Gotta be. Whoa, what is going on? Wow, that's crazy. I have no idea what just happened there, but that was interesting. Okay, so there's the first time I've been able to figure out how to make this sound somewhat neutral with stereo. It still is doing something, obviously, with FM and the input level. Treble boost is on. Right, so that's a pretty clean stereo effect. Okay, cool. So this is something I just learned today, just now. Right. So, in this case, you can hear the left is number one and the right is number two. Right? Pretty nifty. Okay, let's trigger the signal just by itself. Let's use the LFO. Right. So you can use the LFO at the same time as you use anything else you want. So the ADSR, let's say. Right. So there's you can combine these things. Link in and link out. I'm not sure how this is supposed to work. Well, that sounds cool. I guess it's trying to patch the input to the output. Hmm. unless this links the filter envelope followers. I don't know. I can hear the kick drum. Like, I can hear that, but I don't know. I don't know how that's supposed to work. I think this will send... Okay, I think these are different processing. So this is going to send the ADSR output out of 5. So in order to listen to that, let's create a new audio track. And let's listen from our copy of Phutura Filteroid out 5/6. And let's set it to in. Oh, wow. It's only the envelope. So that's, it's like only the signal it's using to detect it. Sounds like. Interesting. Or maybe this is a way to hear what is stimulating it. I don't quite understand this, guys. But maybe you could set up some kind of complex signal following thing. I'm not sure. Again, you need a deep kick to trigger. Things. All this, also this adds harmonics to the resonance, I think. And then you can also have the LFO go somewhere. Let's do that. I don't know what this is going to sound like. Let's go into Phutura. In. Interesting. I'm not sure why you'd ever want this. Unless you create a loopback. Wait a minute. If you could take LFO out 5, signal or FM in 5. Can you create some kind of feedback loop there? That's what it sounds like, maybe. Out 5, in 5. I don't know if that's necessarily true. Let's stop triggering that. Let's bypass the ADSR. Okay. Yeah, some shit is... Okay. Doesn't sound like it's creating a loop of any kind. Out 5 to... I guess you would just do this if you wanted the LFO to modulate the FM. And you have to still use this. Right. And then you have, you can hear how slippery it makes that. Adds like a distortion almost. In addition to this, you also have the ability to change the LFO shape, I believe. In order to do this, I'm going to have to... Yeah, see, here's a saw. Sign. I'm not sure. I guess that's the envelope follower to trigger the LFO. Let's see. Let's try that. Doesn't seem to be working that way. Huh, interesting. And then we have these filter correction knobs, which is, I think these act like bias. I'm not quite sure, but I found when they're at the maximum value, LH, they sound much louder. It's modulating now. Oh, I wonder if that messes with the... Oh, it seems to mess with the harmonics too. I guess it's something on the output. Also interesting to note here is if you increase the resonance, the amplitude gets quieter. Probably desired. Right. So that, oh yeah, and then the amplitude modulation. So you can also modulate amplitude, which is obviously volume. At the lower modulation rate settings, higher you can get almost like a ring mod sound. This is the mix, full up, or none. And then this is also, there's an AR envelope on this side, in filter two. And I think this only... Also the LFO is... LFO depth is bipolar. So if we turn these both into low pass filters and we go into serial mode, we should have effectively a... I don't know how many poles the slope is. I'd imagine it's 12 and 12, so we're probably at 24 now. Interestingly here is that the LFO only modulates the first filter in the series. You can hear. And then let's trigger the AR envelope using our MIDI. So you get that attack and release. Right, so I made a couple demonstrations using this, which I kind of already showed you guys, I believe. Yeah, I think I did. I think it was patch 3. and we can just look over this again. Might have been patch two. No, it's this one. So it's just side chaining the cutoff. Right, nothing special there. And then lastly, you can use melodic stuff to sidechain it as well. So, beat burner, not beat breaker, beat burner. And then we can send our kick in there as well. Take this down. So for pads, you don't really need a compressor. You could just use this kind of thing. Let's see if we can find something that's more suitable for compression. And knowing what we know now, control the whole thing using our mod wheel. Pretty cool. This sounds like a super soft patch. Yeah, let's do that trick again. Let's use pitch bend. Yeah, that is the Phutura free VST plugins. They are pretty awesome. I'll do another video on the BlueARP and some other stuff, but this is again that song that I created using only those plugins. Not even Philteroid was not here. Thanks for watching. If you liked the channel, feel free to subscribe. Please leave a like. Please leave some comments. Anything. Give me some love. That's going to do it for this video. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.